Thank you for coming again. It's a hard time of the semester to do things, but we are extremely excited to have Sadik Jalal Al-Azm and Bilal Khbeiz here this evening. They're going to be having a discussion. And the aim of this series is partly to inject a little more self-reflexivity into the discussions around the contemporary state of cultural practice in the Middle East. We apparently live in a postmodern or post-postmodern age, and yet I'm constantly surprised to find, often in the context of very sophisticated discussions or publications, terms of nationality, religion, or ethnicity inserted baldly as if they were entirely transparent and sort of representative of a fully developed argument in and of themselves, which I think is a mistake. What these terms mean are held up as self-evident, and in other cases, various terms like Middle East, Islamic, or woman are triangulated as if this gesture alone also added up to an argument. So tonight's question concerns the construction of the Arab intellectual by ways of various media and within various academic and cultural circles. The title, The Plight of the Arab Intellectual, is meant somewhat ironically, implying that this elusive being, the Arab intellectual, is in fact something of a myth, reflecting on the one hand a demand for an interlocutor who will explain them to us or represent us to them or articulate us to ourselves. What is at stake in making these demands, and what do these demands allow and disallow within intellectual discourse is of course especially important to consider within the context of the development of an institution such as NYU Abu Dhabi. So this is the framework for this evening's conversation, and I'll just briefly introduce our speakers. Professor Al-Azm is Professor Emeritus of Modern European Philosophy at the University of Damascus, the author of the controversial classics Self-Criticism After the Defeat, 1968, and Critique of Religious Thought, 1969, as well as works on Kantian philosophy, Orientalism, and the writing of Salman Rushdie. He served as a fellow at the Institute of Advanced Study in Berlin, a fellow at the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars in Washington, D.C., and was awarded the Leopold Lucas Prize from the University of Tübingen in Germany, as well as the Erasmus Prize in Holland in 2004. Bilal Khbeiz is a poet, journalist, and essayist. He is a regular contributor to newspapers Beirut Al-Masset, Al-Nahar, and to Future Television Beirut, and the author of several collections of poetry and books on cultural theory. His work, which includes collaborations and solo projects in the visual arts, has been exhibited at the Venice Biennial in 2003 and the Sharjah Biennial in 2003 and 2007. So without much further ado, I will turn over the microphone to our speakers and just remind everyone to please silence your phones, and there will be a reception afterwards. So thank you.
Thank you.
بس أول شيء أنا بدي أعتذر إنه أنا بحكي بالعربي.
First, I want to apologize that I'm speaking in Arabic.
نقطة تانية بس هيك اللي يعني تقديم صادق جلال العظم بفتكر هيك محرج.
Introducing Sadik Jalal Al-Azm is embarrassing almost for a couple of reasons.
وشي يعني ما بعرف إذا في حدا بالمنطقة من جيلي أكبر مني بيقدر يقدم صوت.
I don't know if there's anyone in the region from my generation or even older who can introduce Sadik Jalal Al-Azm.
المقابلة الأخيرة من المقابلات الأخيرة اللي عملها صادق جلال العظم بيقول بيسأله الصحافي بيقول له
One of the last conversations he had with the journalists, they asked him if why are there not a lot of debates that he takes part of. And he replied, I don't want to write. I write when I have the time to write, but this is my capacity. Sadik Jalal Al-Azm doesn't write much anymore. He thinks a lot about the region. But when he writes, he's the most audacious of us all and the most acute in terms of his analysis. And we knew the and we know the parameters of the crisis from him.
العلمانيين بالمنطقة كانت بمعنى من المعاني مرات تكون مش كثير منيحة. صادق جلال العظم.
He always used to say that the Destinism intellectuals and and secular intellectuals in the region is not an easy destiny.
سجل مع الحرية. سجل مع
But Sadik Jalal Al-Azm has had many encounters with debates around secularism and about all the issues that face the Arab world, and he was always one of the intellectuals who take responsibilities for the for his comments and for his writing. At the end, Sadik Jalal Al-Azm contributed immensely to enriching the intellectual life in the Arab world. And it's enough to say that no one that I was impressed with more than Sadik Jalal Al-Azm, at least in the region or in Lebanon. I would like to ask him some questions this evening. Maybe for the Americans in the audience, these questions might not be very important. But I believe that the region, my region, the Arab world, is not very known and needs to be introduced and needs, maybe the questions won't be very useful. I will try to seek some answers for some questions that I've been thinking about revisiting his work.
أوكي دائما ما تعلن أنك ماركسي ودائما ما يساء فهم إعلانك هذا الثقافة العربية عموما تستهوي تنميط الناس ووضعها في إطارات ضيقة مما يعفي البعض من مغبة النقاش مثل القول هذا المفكر هو مفكر ماركسي إذا نحن نعرف كيف سيكون موقفه من هذه المسألة أو تلك أو القول هذا الليبرالي ونحن نعرف ما الذي
You always announce that you're Marxist and you always your announcement always creates some controversy and by saying that you're a Marxist what do you really exactly mean and in what way are you a Marxist?
Gratitude to the institute here for NYU and to Claire and Carrie and so on for the invitation and the hospitality and thanks to all of you for showing up and coming. And I know this is a particularly difficult time of the year, especially at the university NYU. First of all, I would like to make a comment on what Claire said. It seemed to me as if she said something about the myth of the Arab intellectual or the Arab intellectual being something of a myth. I think not quite right, not quite correct. The Arab intelligentsia has played a very important role from about the beginning of the 20th century, or if some take it back to Tahtawi, to, you know, Muhammad Ali's Muhammad Ali Pasha's rule, and in the absence of institutions, in the absence of political parties, in the absence of other structures in society, actually it is the intelligentsia that filled the vacuum, and they have been at the forefront both of formulating, I mean, as intellectuals, they were trained to be able to formulate the topics and subjects that are for public debate, and had the instruments and the concept and the language to propose them for discussion. Very often they were also at the head of political movements, especially movement that sought, say, independence from colonialism, the anti-colonial struggle. So I think to describe, you know, the intellectuals in the Arab world and their role and so on, in terms of something mythical and so on, is, I think, unfair and shortchanging the role of the intelligentsia. And we have had a very good example of this fairly recently. When President Assad died and his son took over, Bashar, and we had something which was called, you know, the short Damascus spring, it was amazing that after 40 years of censorship, control, banning books, banning novels, tearing newspapers, and so on, it was amazing how good and brilliant the Syrian intelligentsia suddenly acted. Okay? From the political communique that they issued, known as Charter 99, okay? To the kind of analyses that they were able to present of the Syrian situation, of the impasse in which Syria was finding itself, and not just Syria, but within the context of the Arab world, the Palestine problem, the struggle with Israel, it was amazing. It was as if 40 years of attempted control and attempted censorship and so on hadn't existed. They had been ended up in the dustbin of history. When they started coming out and writing, and here we have to thank Lebanon, okay, because most of the stuff was being done in published in Lebanon. It was amazing how well informed they were, how up to date they were. How close to, you know, to world events, okay, and how they understood extremely well the internal situation in Syria and the problems and the impasse that, you know, Syria had reached and the regime had reached. Actually, at one point, there was some discussion going on, and it was the regime that was promoting it. Why don't we follow, this was around, you know, the year 2001 maybe, okay, why don't we follow the Chinese model, okay? In other words, strict control from the top, you know, iron fist and so on, at the same time a liberalized economy at the base. And when he just came out of jail, Michel Kilo published an article with the following title, Chinese Solution to a Soviet Problem, and that immediately killed the entire entire, you know, discussion on this at least declared policy of trying to imitate the Chinese. So since our overall topic has to do with the intellectual, the plight of the intellectual. I wanted to introduce saying that the defending the role of the intellectuals, and of course the role they played is bigger in the Arab world than, say, it would be in a lot of other places for a variety of reasons. And in a way, they were in this were influenced by the French more than, say, the Anglo-Saxon tradition. Okay, the role of the intellectuals, in the French tradition, has influenced. Now I come to the question. Now, what is interesting is that, I say about myself, I'm a Marxist, and the ones who most misunderstands are the Marxist comrades and friends and so on, all right, for a simple reason, because Marxism had become part of a state ideology. Okay? And Marx had been routinized, okay, scripturalized. It's almost like a scripture that became, and I never myself either, belonged to that camp, okay, or at any one time used the Marxist method in a dogmatic manner and form. For me, the primary aspect of Marxism was the critical aspect of Marxist thought. And, practically in every important publication of Marx, there is always a subtitle called critique of something or the other. And that's what I appropriated from him, basically the critical method in approaching institutions, situations, policies, politics, and so on. And the second point for me had the explanatory power of Marxism through emphasis on production, the economy, okay, and the influence of production, the way people make their living, and the economy in explaining other aspects of society that usually are, I think, left badly explained or unexplained. And I'll tell you a story since we are here in the United States. Remember that when President Clinton was running the first time for the presidency, the economy was lousy, not as lousy as now, but was lousy. And he said, the economy is stupid. Okay, that's what, and then I was then at the Wilson Center, and everybody was speaking, even in the New York Times, about how the economy will determine the political process. And then I told my friends, I said, I've never seen the Americans in a more Marxist mood than this. They said, what do you mean? I said, what did Marx say? What was his message? Okay. Look at the economy, stupid. Okay, if you want to explain the political process, the social process, what is happening, ultimately, okay, you look at the economy, at the production process. Again now, okay, there is not only a revival of talk about Marx now that the economy is bad, but Keynes also, okay, and going back. When the economy is going well, you forget this, okay, but when problems arise, okay, it seems, there is a retrieval again of Marx. And finally, on this, and here, in the papers I received about this session, there was something about the kind of, language and positions available to the intellectual living and working, say, in a place like the Arab world, okay? And Marxism was a very convenient language, okay, and positions whereby you can deal with the problems of underdevelopment, okay, the problems of production and so on, without at the same time seeming like a stooge or lackey of the colonial powers or of the of imperialism and so on. So it was a critical, okay. At the same time, you could be critical. You could adopt these positions without, in the process of doing so, seeming as if you know you are serving the colonial masters. Sorry for taking so long, man.
Okay. ممكن السؤال الثاني مرتبط بالسؤال الأول.
I will ask a second question that is related to the first question.
اشتغلت بالفلسفة عموما.
You worked in philosophy in general. And you know very well that Western philosophy is connected to modernity and its different facets. You have debated with the church and against it, with religion and against it. You always said that we have to confront the religious with the historical and the mythological with the scientific. And I agree with your position. But do you think that the religious is something universal that can be applied in the East and in the West, within Islam, Christianity, Buddhism, and Judaism?
And
do you think that the question that what happened in the beginning of modernity and what followed with debates and discussions and confrontations with the church is capable of being universalized on a theoretical basis to what should happen with Islam?
Of course,
This is the missing link that had resulted
among
in
the
what
world,
we face, the aggression that we face in the
world. We call them religions, so there must be something common or shared as systems of beliefs, systems of normative systems of ethics, or explanations, kind of cosmogonies of how you know the world came around and so on. But at the same time, of course, they are very different. Now, on the issue of facing, as you said, al-ghaybi, namely the unseen, okay, with the historical and the mythical in religion, of course, with the with science. My first observation is that it is interesting that we speak a lot about the conflict between science and religion. And now it's here in the States, it's of course very alive now, especially under the rubrics of intelligent design, creation science, and so on. But is it really religion and science, or is it really three religions and science? We never, as far as I'm concerned, I have, at least very rarely, I've never heard of a conflict of religion and science, say, in Buddhism. And Buddhism is a world historical religion. I've never heard of a conflict of science and religion between Hinduism, another world historical religion, and science. Now, the question is, why is it limited to basically, okay, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam? Okay, that's one question which to some extent occupies me, okay, and sometimes bothers me. Is it monotheism, for example? Or is it the idea of the total monopoly on the truth, okay, absolute truth of the world? And there is a lot of in this, I don't know what to call it, semitico-centrism, okay? Because when you think in terms of religion versus science, you are really thinking of the three Semitic religions, okay, as quote-unquote, okay? So this is, you know, especially the Arabs, you know, they keep accusing the Europeans of Eurocentrism. Yeah. But when it comes to the conflict between science and religion, the only religions that count, of course, are the Semitic religions. And then they are also even more the Arabs vis-à-vis Islam, even more Arabocentric, is that if you are not Sunni and Arab, then there is something wrong with your Islam. Okay, that's not said, okay, but of course subjectively I know it, okay, and we all know it, and when we say it among ourselves, nobody objects really, okay. Is that so you have to be Arab and Sunni, okay, you know, and this in many ways angers most of the other Muslims of the world who are not Arab, okay, and of course I've seen it in my classes, in my interaction with scholars, with colleagues and so on, who also object to the fact that we as Arabs monopolize, okay, true Islam for ourselves. Now, the question of the church is very important now, okay, because one of the arguments of the Islamists, especially someone like Qaradawi, for example, okay, is that there is no problem of Islam and secularism, because in the first place, secularism arose in opposition to the church in Europe. And in Islam, there is no church, and therefore there is no problem. Okay, this is, in my view, complete sophistry, okay, in, on this. And in, of course, it's, in reply, you just point out that, for example, in India, right, the most ardent defender of the secularity of the Indian state are the Muslims, the Muslim minority, okay? Primarily because they don't want to live, let's say, under Hindu Sharia, okay, or, you know, Hindu whatever it is, okay? So in India, there is no church. There's, you know, there's not even, you know, a single language to unify the country. Their lingua franca is English. Okay, but still the Muslims insist on the secularity of the state, and they want to defend it. So for me, it's not a question of consistently transferring something from, you know, what happened in one part of the world to another. It's really a much more practical question. Now in Iraq, okay, suppose the Iraqis want to avoid civil war, sectarian war, the dismemberment of their country. They have to make concessions to each other. Okay, what kind of concessions they have to make? You know? Well, certainly one of the concessions that they have to make is that the Shia have to make the concession that they cannot have Shia Sharia run the country, rule the country. Okay, they cannot have, Iraq cannot become an imamate, okay, or vice imamate or deputy imamate. You cannot, Iraq cannot be a wilayat al-faqih, okay, rule of the jurist. Country, otherwise it's civil war. Okay, okay, it can't be under Sunni Sharia law. All right, it cannot be under Christian rule. So, what do you call it? The government. Well, you don't like secular. Okay, you say in Arabic Madani. All right, you say have hukuma madaniya. I mean civil government. All right. Okay, so. The question is not whether, you know, what worked in Europe will work for us. It's much more vital, immediate issue. If you don't do it, okay, this is what's going to happen to happen to Iraq. Right? Something similar in Lebanon. Okay, if you don't have, and I'm speaking here about, you know, secularism in its absolute minimalist sense, in the sense of the benign neutrality, relative neutrality of the state vis-a-vis the sects, the confessions, the religions, the ethnicities that make up the country. Okay. If we don't have that, I think the result is going to be other civil wars and sectarian wars and Shia killing Sunni and Sunni killing Shia. And one time in the last time in Damascus we were having discussing this issue, I said, look, the Russians, this was in central Damascus, the Russians have apologized to the Hungarians, okay, for what they did to them in the past. The Japanese have, you know, apologized to the Koreans, okay, for, you know, the wrongs that they have, and so on. The whites in South Africa apologized to the blacks, you see, for apartheid. Muslims were asking the Pope to apologize for the Crusades, okay, and actually the Pope, the earlier Pope, in the Umayyad Mosque in Damascus, did actually issue the apology. So I said, why don't the Sunnah apologize to the Shia for the massacre, okay, that killed Hussein? And we will ask the Shia, please, to accept the apology, and let's finish with this. just as, okay, also, the Pope absolved Jewish posterity from the blood of Jesus, didn't he? Okay. So let them absolve us, Sunnah, okay, from the blood of Hussein as a posterity. Okay. Now, this was my proposal. By the way, it's not funny, because we have a saying sometimes we laugh because it's so dire, so difficult. العتاب صابون القلوب. Okay. It's not just, you know, العتاب صابون القلوب, it's something like, you know, apologizing is the soap that washes the heart. Okay. And when you apologize, you apologize the damage is done. You apologize for the future. Okay, that's hopefully you make a better future after the apology, and that's the, you know, I think it's, from this point of view, it's a serious matter. Okay, the apology, if it acts as a sabun al qulub, okay, the detergent that washes the hearts, and for the sake of the future relations of Shia and Sunnah. Go ahead, of course. You should have.
Can I ask you another question?
Actually,
what I'm thinking about is practically the secularists.
وعليه نشأت هذه التقسيمات القضائية اللي احنا عندنا والتقسيمات الاجتماعية مشكلة بالمنطقة
the problem in the region
بشدد على السؤال مشكلة بالمنطقة انه نحن اول تقسيم بيحصل هو تقسيم ديني
the problem in the region is that the first type of classificatory system that happens is along religious lines
اجتماعي او الاقتصادي هذا بيعتمد على الديموغرافي
Not so much socio-economic, but more on religious, which creates a lot of conflict.
But
when one looks at the Western example, one feels confronted with the possibility of civil war. Of course, I agree with you. That the universalizing the experiment will not work by imposing it in other contexts. And I believe that only a secular civil experiment is one that can succeed in
the
regions to avoid
the religious
conflict.
I think we have something to build on. The fact that, unlike in at least Western Christianity, and as you said, you know, they threw out the Jews and they threw out the Muslims and so on, especially after the Reconquista and so on. at least we have an advantage in Islam, is that the Christian and the Jews and a few others were regarded as Ahlul Kitab, the, you know, protected minority, and were tolerated. It was a medieval form of tolerance. Okay, there is no reason why we can't build on this in order to advance to a higher level of tolerance. And even here, the word tolerance is not the right one, because you tolerate pain, you tolerate some irritant or something. I don't, you know, want the non-Muslims of the Arab world to, you know, feel that they are just tolerated. Okay, I want acceptance. I want citizenship, okay, to be the central concept in all this. And again, I say this: this is not just a ijtihad point of view and so on. I think it's such a vital necessity now for us, if we are not going to, you know, fall into another struggle, say in Syria, between Alawi and Sunni, okay, or now in Lebanon between Shia and Sunni. I'm not saying this is, you know, can be done magically, but this is, I think, this what the intelligentsia, the enlightened, and so on, must work with and for. Okay, as I said, we can build on the idea of the medieval idea of tolerance, that Islam, I think, was more advanced on this than at least European Christianity. I see it more as a vital necessity, where the alternative is so painful. It's on pain of almost destroying your yourself if you don't do it. Especially that, in effect, now there is a kind of de facto acceptance of the minorities of the Arab world, except, you know, in place like Saudi Arabia and so on, de facto acceptance of them as citizens. In other words, the Egyptian soldiers who died in the wars, in our wars with Israel, okay, are treated, you see, as shuhada and their families and so on. Now, from, you know, and the Murshid, general guide of the Muslim Brothers, okay, this he finds unacceptable, and he has said, he said, we have to get the Copts out of the army, yeah, okay, of the Egyptian army. So, but de facto, the state cannot do that. What I will call for is that we have to have the courage, okay, to face this problem squarely and directly, okay. It's not enough de facto to treat these minorities as citizens. We have to face it directly, and at some point say, okay, the ordinance of Ahl al-Zimma is null and void. Okay, the ordinance, you know, the rules that apply to what was called Ahl al-Zimma is like the rules that apply to slaves. Okay, and now they are all inoperative, they have lapsed. Okay, now if you look at the Sharia books and so on, they are full of rules and regulations. Sharia is full about slavery, okay, how to deal with slaves and what to do and so on. Okay, and I would say that the ordinances and rules and regulations that have to do with Ahl al-Zimma, okay, we have to be faced directly, and we have to say that they are caduc, they are, you know, they have lapsed, and, you know, they are not operative, and not just de facto, okay, but de jure. And there are others. It's not only this. There are several that need to be faced. And I think there is a failure of nerve on the part of the centers of religious learning and so on, they just paper over this, okay, and they don't want to face it directly.
You've talked several times about the Turkish experiment as an experiment that can be useful for the Arab world, or an experiment that we can take some lessons from. However, I'd like to ask you about the problems with the Turkish experiment.
اللي حكيته هو يعني أنا أفكر طيب إذا كنا نحن إسلام سنة لنقول بمصر.
I'm also thinking that if we as Muslims
إذا كانوا سنة وأقباط بمصر وإنه نقبل إنه يكون في مواطنية كاملة الصفات.
For example, in Egypt, citizenship is applied to both Muslims and Christians.
توقفنا واعي لحالك طوائف. والسنة اللي واعيين لحالهم كسنة يضل العلاقة بيناتهم إنه بيضل القبطي مواطن غير كامل الصفات وما بحق له مثل ما بحق للسنة للسنة. وهذا قد يحصل بلبنان، قد يحصل بسوريا، الجزائر. وقد يحصل تحديدا بتركيا.
This idea of citizenship where the civil institutions guarantees the rights of Copts, Christians and Muslims. This can also happen in Algeria, in Lebanon. So if we talk about the Turkish experiment, to what extent is it universalized?
First of all, the first part, what you said, this is why I, you know, to some extent, taking into account that between the de jure situation and the de facto situation. And if we are courageous enough at the level of the de jure to issue laws or legislations and so on, these very quickly become a good fighting instrument, okay, for changing the, say, excessive sectarianism of the Qutti or the excessive sectarianism of the Sunni. Movements can arise, okay, that would want to turn or implement the law from merely de jure situation to a de facto situation. And this, we have seen it in history a lot. The Constitution says all are equal, okay. But at the same time, we know that, you know, the chances that if you are a Christian becoming a president, okay, it becomes, you know, here, if you are, the chances used to be used hopeless even for a Catholic, let alone a black, okay. But if the principle is there, then you can fight on the basis of that principle in order to make change in reality. And we should not underestimate, even if the laws feel formal only, okay, we should not underestimate their importance if you want to make use of them as an instrument for changing the reality, the sectarian reality, to a more citizenship reality, then they can be used. And here comes the role of the Turkish experience. Now, Kemal Atatürk had a society that was, you know, inherited from the Ottomans. Okay, still, you know, at the level of the state, he was able to procure certain laws, legislations, rules and regulations, and so on, that eventually, after a long time, were able to transform Turkish society to the point where a party like Erdogan's can take power peacefully, can take power democratically, and really democratically, not, you know, the way it happens in Egypt and Syria and so on. And I'm convinced that had it not been for the Kemalist experiment, okay, the fate of political Islam in Turkey wouldn't have been any better than the fate of political Islam, say, in Algeria or Syria. Yeah. It is the Kemalist experiment, okay, which historically I think matured and succeeded by allowing, ultimately, its test came when it allowed the Islamic party or background party to assume power the way it did. And the test will come again when, if they lose the elections, that, you know, they will actually let the new majority take over and then reorganize themselves in you know, to be able to become a majority, a ruling majority again. In relationship to the Arab world, you know that until very recently, the left in the Arab world hated Turkish policies, okay? Of course, because of NATO, because of the alliance with the West, because of recognition of Israel, and so on. And now, lo and behold, after what happened, the left looks around in the area, and where, in which country is there a minimal semblance, at least, okay, of some civil society, of serious elections, okay, of political parties, a free press, and it's only Turkey. Actually, when Bush was preparing to invade Iraq, the Turks, the Turkish parliament, okay, said no, you remember, okay, to stationing troops and so on. And Bush had to swallow it, because the parliament is a genuine parliament. What Arab king, what Arab ruler can go to Bush and tell him, my parliament said no, okay, without Bush laughing him off the stage, okay? I think this is, you know, quite important for model or paradigm for, you know, the Arab world too. Now, even the Islamists, they hated not only Turkish policies and so on, they hated, you know, the entire experiment of Turkey traditionally because of Kemalism and secularism and, of course, Israel and NATO. And now we have several attempts in Egypt, in Syria, okay, to create out of the mainstream Muslim Brothers something like Erdogan's party. In Egypt, is Hizb al-Wasat, okay? The attempt to create something called the Party of the Middle, right, out of the Muslim brothers. Their model is Erdogan. In Syria, it's even called the Party of Justice and Construction, okay? They are calling it that. Even the name, you know, half the name has been taken over in order to, you know, and they are asking themselves, okay, look at where is now, or how did political Islam in Turkey evolve? And look at Arab political Islam. Where is it? Okay.
من الكمالية التركية بلش اعتراض أو في التجاهل المؤسسة الدينية اللي كانت هي مؤسسة داخلية.
To add to what you said, that part of the Kemalist experiment kind of happened on the expense of religion.
لجانب علماء الدين المتنورين كان دائما في مثقفين علمانيين. السؤال شقين. دائما الى جانب رجال الدين المتنورين بال 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 تاريخ النهضة العربية
أو ما يصلح
كان في مخطفين سؤال له شقين أولا أين العلماني
My question is, how is a secular intellectual born in the region?
ابن عيلة وابن منطقة وابن طائف
أكثر من هيك ابن عيلة صعب
وبتعلم باختبار المحن يكون علماني
How does a secular person get born and becomes a citizen and what kind of experiences are requisite for the construction of a secular person? A lot of people go through a secular phase when they're 20 and then they revert back to something else.
وين بيولد العلماني كيف شو دوره
How is a secular person born and what is the role
يعني اذا استتباعا على الحكي عن الكماليه اي مؤسسه دينيه قد تكون متنوره لحد تفتح نقاش محل
and what is the role of the religious establishment and to what extent can the religious establishment be enlightened to open the debate about secularism
now it is interesting that family law or personal status law which is still governing you know our lives as you said and with some modifications okay in countries probably like Syria Egypt and Tunis and modifications now what for me is interesting is that this situation with family law is defended tooth and claw by the religious power structures. Why? Because it's the only left thing really left for them. Okay. In other words, over the 20th century, they have lost education. Okay. They have lost the army. They have lost the media. All the economy and so on. Really, nothing in a place like Syria or Egypt or Algeria, okay, Iraq, runs according to Islamic rules and laws. Okay, and when the Islamists come and say we want the immediate application of Sharia law, they are right. It's not applied. Okay, the only thing left. But de facto, okay, nobody declares it de jure, openly. Okay. The only thing left for the power structure are awqaf, the religious endowments, okay, which anyway have been incorporated in the state. It's a wazara, okay, and family law. And this they will defend, okay, because it's, you know, at the start it was never tampered with or changed, and it's the only preserve that they is still left for them. You know, for example, in Syria, in the educational system, right, there is some religion, but of course it's so wishy-washy because you know Syria has 40% minorities, all right. So it has to be so wishy-washy. Okay, religious instruction. And anyway, in our culture and country, you don't get your religion from school or from the government. Okay? You get it at home. So nobody really listens to or takes seriously the whatever religion is taught in school. And then you go up to what we call the baccalaureate. This is the high school, okay, up there. And this is an exam that comes at the end of the year. It decides more or less your future. Okay, the first 10% go medicine, the second 10% dentistry, the third will go into pharmacy and etc. Okay, there is an exam in religion, but when it comes to deciding your future, that doesn't count. So when you know, you say how many grades, what was your average in the baccalaureate, and you give two averages. You say, so, for example, 220, okay, with religion, without religion. Okay. Without religion is what decides your future. It's emblematic, you see, of the hypocrisy, okay, that goes on in the in the system. And still, I think the religious power structure, you know, want to insist and defend, because really, in many ways, de facto, this is what was left to them. And now the Islamist movement, I interpreted as a kind of attempt at a reconquista, okay, to reconquer whole realms of society that they regard as theirs by right, and almost divine right, and that historically have been under their control, and throughout the 20th century, okay, have been wrested out by the state from them. I think this is why they, you know, in Lebanon, whenever, say, a suggestion is made for civil marriage, you find, okay, all of them, all the religious power structures, okay, Maronite, Orthodox, Sunni, Shia, on this they will all, okay, come together, and they agree on nothing else, but this one, no, because it's taking one more piece of power from them, okay, even if you make the civil marriage in Lebanon voluntary, okay, it's up to you completely to do it this way or that way, they regard it as a diminishing of their control beyond all that has been diminished. To go back to something about the about Turkey, why Turkey? You know, I think Turkey was the center of the empire. Okay, we were the periphery. So I think it makes a lot of difference when you are the periphery and when you are the center. The center of the empire, for example, was able to fight back throughout the allies, okay, and never, you know, permit, you know, colonial rule and so on, while the remaining periphery of the empire, which was mainly the Arab, what became the Arab states, and so on, being the periphery, were never able really to fight back the French and British and Italians and so on, and we, you know, were subjected to the colonial rule for, you know, with Algeria it was 130 years on this. And the fact that the Tanzimat, okay, had started earlier, they were much stronger in the center. Tanzimat is the, you may call it, the Ottoman perestroika. When they tried to do their own perestroika, the Ottoman, and I think had it not been for the Tanzimat, and had it not been that the Tanzimat were strong enough in the center, but not so strong or not strong enough in the periphery of the empire, the fact that they happened in the center and they happened thoroughly and more strongly is what allowed Turkey to fight back and throw out the allies occupying you know, Turkey then, while, you know, we were not able to do that.
I'd like to address the question or point that you addressed to me initially, which you pointed out my very clumsy use of the word myth. And of course, I'd be mortified if everyone here went away thinking that I thought Arab intellectual life was a myth, which is clearly not the case. I think what I was trying to point to was that it's an extremely important part of the history and present of the region, and that it's, because of that, it's also something that is fiercely negotiated, debated, guarded, and I think this was what I was thinking of when I came to this, the idea for this event. And I wonder if you could perhaps discuss, in relation to some of the points you've raised this evening and your own experience, what it is, as someone who's able to extremely successfully negotiate, you know, a presence both within the U.S. and Europe, as well as in the Middle East, what it is you find that, you know, allows that legibility in one place and disallows it in another, for example, or what is it that translates in certain in the U.S., for example, and doesn't translate in Syria, or vice versa?
Well, first of all, I don't think, you know, there is a use of the word myth there, which, you know, is justifiable. Now, first of all, although I defended the intellectual, but I also know that they themselves often mythologize themselves. Okay, and that, of course, maybe would be the topic for another kind of discussion, where, you know, we want to point out the defects and shortcomings and problems and so on, not only the plight, okay, but, you know, their own failures, okay, including myself, okay. And they do mythologize themselves sometimes, and sometimes they're sorry, you know, they... Second, there's another kind of mythologizing. Okay. The state, sometimes, which doesn't like them, okay, mythologizes them in the other direction. Right? It gives them, you know, far more importance, far more significance, power, and so on, than they really have or can do, or also for its own purposes. Okay. These things, you know, go on, and you are constantly in the Arab world, as an intellectual, especially if you are also a public intellectual, having to navigate these, and there are no hard and fast rules. Okay, it's very fluid, very changing. You do it partly by intuition, by hunch, by intelligence, by, you know, etc., to be able to navigate these pressures, the, you know, the intellectual mythologizing themselves, the state mythologizing them, and then after the mythologizing, repressing and oppressing, and so on. For me, personally, I had early on taken a decision, okay, that as far as I can, I will avoid being an Arab intellectual in exile. Okay. In other words, short of having to spend the rest of my life in jail, right, or short of, you know, martyrdom or something like that, I'd rather make the kind of concessions necessary to be able to do what I basically did, namely be able, you know, to move between my own people, culture, background, and so on, and the rest of the of the world. I regard that as a, you know, personal decision and commitment. I am not in this making in any way a negative judgment or anything like that about those who couldn't manage, okay, such a navigate such a situation. They felt that, you know, they were in mortal danger and had to leave, or they, you know, completely went into silence and so on. I perfectly understand and respect, you know, their decisions. Okay. Again, there is no, you know, one hard fast rule for all that. But this was my own decision, just as. Those who have, you know, went as Arab intellectuals, say, to, you know, France or Rome or New York and so on, have had to make also their own concessions, their own compromises, okay, with the environment surrounding them. I, having made the decision, okay, to try as long as I can, okay, not to become an exile, or an intellectual in exile, I also had to make my own compromises, my own concession, in order to maintain that balance. Okay, this meant that more or less in Syria and Lebanon, you know, always sort of, you know, living on the edge. Okay, and for me, my two cities are Beirut and Damascus. And when it gets, you know, a bit the heat too high in Beirut, I, you know, go and stay in Damascus, and until, you know, things cool down, and vice versa. when it gets hot in Damascus, I go to Beirut and wait out and see what happens. The last incident was the declaration of Damascus, Beirut, Beirut, Damascus. Okay, and once it was published, the Syrian leaders of that, about 15 people were all rounded up and thrown in jail. Okay, I happened to be at Princeton at the time. Yeah, so what did I do? I changed my airplane ticket. Instead of landing in Damascus, I changed it to Beirut. Okay, so I landed in Beirut. Okay, waited out until things cooled down. Some of them went out of jail, and the, of course, Middle East style, you call friends and friends who know friends and who know the girlfriend of somebody who is, powerful and etc. And see, and then they tell you, okay, you give you the green light. Okay, you take a much smaller risk that way. Then I went to Damascus. Earlier, for example, I can say that in 1970, over the problem with my book, probably I was the first one ever to take, in those days, refuge from Beirut in Damascus. Okay, it was in those days, it was always the opposite. Okay, it was the Syrians who were running away to Beirut, but I was the first one to go the other way in this. And I'm not complaining in a way. It's a choice I made, the decision I took, and I think on the whole I managed to succeed in this, in being at the same time with the world, in the world, okay, as well as within my own people, culture. Formulating the terms of the debate, entering the polemics, and so on, without so far ending up in a very sorry state.
Thank you, and thank you for speaking this evening. I wanted to follow up with a question. This is my last, and then I'll open it for Bilal, which is more or less the same question in light of your recent move to LA from Beirut and your experience as a writer, as a journalist, as a poet. How do you understand the constraints that are put on you or the avenues that are opened up to you being in Beirut and being in the Middle East in general and being in the US and negotiating those two different spheres as an Arab intellectual?
As a person coming from the Middle East in general, Beirut in particular, I keep on thinking how America was for me. I always say that I am a writer in Beirut, but I'm a reader in America. I'm always keen on reading what is produced in what is called advanced systems or advanced societies. And negotiating the position between the reader and the writer was is something that I think about a lot. Practically, when I first arrived in the US after a very bitter political experience in Beirut, I kept on asking myself if what we were doing back in Lebanon really right? Is it feasible to fight for our national causes, for our freedoms, because practically it's not a fear of exile. Exile is a fear that is present in the mind of the person exiled. And this is one of the first things that I asked Professor Al-Azm. How do you become a Marxist? How do you... When I first arrived here, I felt that I was not Bilal Khbeiz. I felt that I was not the writer Bilal Khbeiz. I felt that I was a reader. But the interesting thing is what I've read about the U.S. is not what I've seen or what I've experienced when living here. I got a major shock from Los Angeles. Los Angeles, the public space is only found on the freeways.
Because
one is always scared of this public space, one is always scared of the distance between one person and the other, because the cost must be high, and there's no communication. It's all about cocooning. Everyone is in their own shell. So coming to Los Angeles was a major shock. Maybe it's also a bit of a shock for Americans who go to Los Angeles. And it made me think a lot. I'm not saying that. But I have a feeling. And I'm envious of Dr. Al-Azm about his position. And I have a feeling that we don't have a place in our countries. And the secularists have no place to be born in our country, in our regions. There's no fertile ground for us to grow and flourish. And practically, if there's a desire on one's part to return back, as opposed to Sadik's ability to go back, I cannot go back to Lebanon. All those sectarian problems in Lebanon. If you're Jews, that means that you are Syrian. And if you're Sunni, then you should be aligned with Saudi Arabia. So it's not only religious affiliation, it's also political. I don't know, but I think it's enough to talk about these things.
So I'd just like to say one last thank you to you both, and perhaps we have some questions in the audience.
You guys spoke about a lot of things in reference to the Turkish solution, talked about the Marxist solution, brought up Keynes, and you know, there's a variety of different solutions to, you know, predominantly religious issues. And this lecture reminds me of two books, I don't know if you guys have read it, called Crisis of the Negro Intellectual and the Miseducation of the Negro, which has a lot of similar paradigms to it. And I was wondering, you said that there's a Western analysis of religion, and then there's a Semitic analysis. They say that the religions are Semitic, all three of them, and the Westerners think the religions are Western. And historically, all three of those religions are non-Western. They're all African religions. And I was wondering if you ever thought of solving your plight outside of the Western ideology of Marxism and capitalism and start dealing with an Afrocentered perspective by dealing with Afrocentered scholars in this country and around the world that have a completely different idea on how to solve these major issues, since they've been involved with them probably a lot longer than the people in the quote-unquote region.
Please, my hearing is not very good. Could you repeat the last part of the what you said?
Have you thought of looking into an Afrocentered idea of solving your conflict, since all the European paradigms has not worked, meaning communism, capitalism? Have you thought of amalgamating intellectually with Afrocentered scholars around the world, especially in the US?
Well, first of all, you spoke of solutions. Of course, the word solutions didn't occur in all the discussion and debate that we had with myself and Bilal. I mean, we were not really proposing solutions. We were more trying to understand, to some extent, analytically, situations that prevail. Are de facto and so on. We did not go into solutions. What I said about Semitic and so on, well, the Westerners or the Europeans and the Americans, they forget that Christianity is not a Western religion. It's not a European religion. It came out from us. And even all their names, are, whether it's Thomas or Christopher or Mary, and they all come from my side of the Mediterranean, and we gave them those. They gave us in return, we gave them Christianity. They gave us the Enlightenment. Christianity lasted for 2,000 years. Okay, the Enlightenment lasted for 200 years, maybe. This is why I, brought up the question of the Semitic religion. Actually, the West and Europe never produced a major world historical religion. Okay, didn't ever even produce a serious miracle. Okay, I mean the Virgin appears here and there and so on, but but for God to walk on Earth, okay. For God's word to be in, a book like that, where that's our stuff. Okay. It doesn't happen in the. It hasn't, at least so far, really happened in Europe. Now, thinking in terms of completely solving our problems outside all the paradigms that we have known, that modern history has produced, be it capitalism, socialism, and so on. If I start doing that, how would I fend off the accusation of simply being utopian, or being completely up in the air, or mythological, or faking alternative solutions, doing something like science fiction or something like that. Solutions have to come from engaging with whatever reality we have. Okay, I mean, when we had the reality was colonialism, you had to engage with that, in order to come up with some kind of solution. And the idea of political independence, for example, was the the answer. Okay, the problems of capitalism. The working class movement proposed socialism as a reaction, and so on. So I think solutions have to be, in a way, derived and distilled. Out of whatever realities are there. There are people who, think of complete alternatives. Have nothing to do with the reality of capitalism or socialism, but then that's building a completely idealized world of your own, sometimes you may enjoy reading about that, but this is not the kind of thing either myself and I probably would say about Bilal that we are engaged in.
Another question?
North Korea and Venezuela are the best allies of Iran. When 9/11 happened, European leftists said this was not entirely unjustified. How do you explain the fact that there is a Marxist-Islamic alliance?
A Marxist-Islamic alliance?
Where?
Marxists all over the world are basically sympathetic to Islamic causes, and in particular are sympathetic to Islam's opposition to the United States and to Western secularism. Yeah,
well, sympathy is one thing, alliance is another.
In the case of Iran, there is a real Iran, Venezuela, North Korea, a very real alliance in terms of atomic weapons.
Well, first of all, Marxists and socialists and leftists sympathize with whoever is hurting imperialism, whoever is hurting the leading imperialist power, or the empire. That's true. Whether there is an alliance is a different matter, because I think most Marxists in their and analytical work do not think that the tactics and strategies that are being applied by jihadi Islam, not just Islam in general, will eventually lead nowhere. And then you brought up Chavez, and you forgot Gaddafi, But I mean, these are populist jerks. they will, shift and change their alliances, not on, a matter of principle and so on, but because now Iran is acting as if it is the inheritor of the Soviet Union in terms of, which is facing the United States. Chavez would maybe try to some extent to play the old game of the third world that is trying to, during the Cold War, to benefit from both sides. Now it's a game which is deja vu, and of course, as Marx said, first time is tragedy, the second time it's comedy. And now we are in the phase of the comedy on this.
Yeah, maybe two more questions.
Hi, I thought it was actually interesting that you mentioned Turkey regarding their education system being a basis for their success as a country, because in the last 20 years, though they saw their gross domestic product increase, I think by threefold, they've put almost no money into their education system. And they've, so it's been pretty bad for them.
Speak more slowly.
Sure. I'm sorry. I'm American. It's bad.
My hearing is...
No, it's bad for... Americans talk too fast. no, it's true. I'm not German. I slowed down. Turkey, in the last 20 years, saw their gross domestic product increase about threefold. And they actually put almost no money into their education system. And so it's interesting seeing their government shift more religiously and everything. And you were mentioning before how without education, you're going to see the control come through religion. And so just because I had recently talked to someone in the government there, and it was an interesting thing relating to what you're saying. But my main point was that you keep going over the Marxist thing, but at what point does a commitment to Marxism become its own religion? I mean, you're just replacing Islam with Marxism, which is, you can, but I'm sorry, but it's a problem. I mean, we've seen where it goes.
Well, first of all, about Turkey, at no point do I want to say that they, when you look closely at the inside the country, I'm sure they have, massive problems. I was simply discussing it, looking from a distance away, from the perspectives, of somebody who is in Syria or in the Arab world, how from a distance the situation looks, what people, how they are reacting, who is trying to imitate and do something like they did, what they admire, what they don't admire, okay? I'm sure that, you know, if you go inside the, you know, the massive problems, and I don't know much about them. Now, that Marx had been turned into, you know, a kind of religion, I have no doubt about that. This is when I, you know, started by saying that he was scripturalized and routinized and so on. So was Aristotle at one time, okay? He became the philosopher of Catholicism and so on. This has, this happens, okay? But there also what happens is that you rescue a great thinker like Aristotle or like Kant or like Ibn Rushd, Averroes, okay? You rescue him from the prison house, okay, of dogma and doctrine that he has been cast into. And during the 60s, especially here in, you know, and in Europe and so on, we saw something like that, the kind of revival of interest in Marx and Marxism and critical Marxism for the counterculture and the peace movement and the civil rights movement in this country. So I think for my own approach to Marx is very much in the second category rather than the first. And this is when Bilal started and asked about you are misunderstood. And this is why I said it was the Marxists who misunderstood, you know, the way I approached Marx.
It's commonly understood now that you can't have a universal intellectual, that each intellectual is located within a specific historical context with its own pathologies, etc. So, you know, do you buy that, first of all? And if so, do you consider yourself an Arab intellectual, like the title? And if so, then why not a Syrian intellectual or a Muslim intellectual?
Well, the idea that you cannot have a universal intellectual, just like, you know, you cannot have a universal citizen or a universal human being or something like that, because of course we are all individualized and located within very specific situations. But for me, for example, the defense of human rights has become universal, okay? It has universalized itself and has become more or less the measure against which you gauge policies, government, positions of individuals, of intellectuals, and so on. Just as the idea, say, or the universality of the question of human rights originated in Europe. So what? Islam originated in two small desert towns, okay, on the edge of the Roman Empire. It universalized itself historically, okay? So just by saying that it was, you know, an Arab product that happened in two small caravan towns does not detract from its later universality. The same for Christianity, okay? And I would say the same applies, the same logic, to a principle like the defense and application of the idea of universal human rights. It emerged in Europe, and now it's universal, and it's an acquisition for all human beings, and it's also a resource which we use in order to, you know, at least get our friends out of jails and make sure that They get a reasonably fair trial. I'm not saying really fair, but you know, to some extent a fair trial. I think in this sense, universal, yes. There is another form of universality, which the intellectual thing, namely the universality now of scientific knowledge. Okay, you go to Syria, you go to Russia, you go to China, you go, you know, the university curriculum is pretty much the same. Now, how thorough, how good, how cutting edge, and so on is a different matter. Okay, but the universality of scientific knowledge, okay, is something which I don't think a serious intellectual can anymore afford to ignore. And one of the tragedies of at present, I think, of both the Arab world and the Muslim world is that for the last maybe 3-4 centuries, they have not produced any serious scientific knowledge to give to the world. Okay, be it in the physical sciences or the human sciences or the social sciences. And I don't think anybody can, you know, today be a serious intellectual without taking this into serious consideration. The Islamists so far have not produced a single intellectual. They have produced du'at, okay, missionaries. They have produced theoreticians, okay, of their position. But I don't think they have been able to produce critical intellectuals, okay, so far. They have not produced any poets, for example, or playwright, okay. Or serious novelist, okay? There is one, I think, in London. She's writing in English from Sudan, who's taking seriously as a novelist. But at least so far, we haven't seen anything coming from the Islamist camp, except, faqihs, traditional fiqh. And if you look at the interesting ideas coming out from the Islamic world, they certainly are not coming out from the traditional centers of learning. Okay, they are certainly not coming out from Al-Azhar or Al-Zaytuna or the Sharia schools, which exist practically in every Arab capital or every Arab university. Certainly not from Saudi Arabian. I mean, King Abdullah is trying to have a university, and there is a big fight over it going on now. The interesting ideas are coming from two sides. On the right, they are coming from the jihadis. Okay, they are the ones who are thinking beyond the established order. Or on the left, they are coming from someone like Muhammad Shahrour in Syria, namely those who are trying to reform and modernize Islamic theology, doctrine, in the tradition of Nahda, going back to the Mu'tazili, to the idea of Ijtihad, those who are going back to Ibn Rushd, to Averroes, and so on. This is one side that is interesting that is happening within the sphere of Islamic thought. The other one are the coming out from the jihadis, Qutb and his students, and so on. The established centers, especially Al-Azhar, are completely sterile right now. There's nothing going on except regurgitation, fiqh, traditional learning, and doing what the state wants them to do. Okay. Thank you.